first I should say, I'm Loverine Taylor, and I'm on the Water Conservation Task Force for the town of Portola Valley. And I invited Jesse Frohlich of Blue Barrel Stystems, Rainwater Catchment Stystems, to give us a talk on something that is free and pure and falls on our property, and we should keep it, collect it, and use it. So she's going to tell us how to do that today. Her background is she went to school at Stanford. She's an accredited professional of the American Rainwater Catchment Systems Association, ARSCA, which is getting a lot of publicity these days. And she has her own company, Blue Barrel Rainwater Catchment Systems in Santa Rosa. The critical thing is these blue barrels, I just found out from Jesse, are totally recycled. I mean, these are barrels that are used by the food industry to ship, you know, food in, and they can only use them one time. And so she has the brilliant idea to take this and recycle them into rainwater catchment systems, which she can install on your property. So,
it's up to you. Thanks very much. Thanks for being here. We can make this really personalized. What we'll do, my company does do blue barrel systems. It's a multi-daisy chain system using these recycled barrels from the food manufacturing waste stream. And we're based in Santa Rosa, but we're able to serve customers all over the nation, actually, because what we do is partner with food manufacturers who have generate these like mad in their waste streams. So we're harvesting barrels as we harvest rain, I suppose. And then what we sell is a do-it-yourself kit that's a very user-friendly process for helping people to build their own code-compliant rainwater catchment system to a pretty unique design. But today I want to focus on principles and practices, because the principles of rainwater harvesting are really very universal, and whether the blue barrel system is right for you or not, you're in the right place, because we want to encourage rainwater harvesting by any means, and there are certainly lots of ways to do that. So I always start with these nice, and I hope it's not too bright in here, if you can tell, these are pictures of different plants doing their own rainwater harvesting in different ways. I'm always amazed to walk around in a rainstorm or after a rainstorm or during a light rain and just see kind of the different ways that plants are brilliantly automatically designed to collect water and deliver that water right to their root zones. Human communities used to do this better than we do now, because it used to be the only way to have water, especially for communities that weren't situated right along the river. The title of the presentation today is Rainwater Harvesting in Dry Climates Doesn't Make Sense, because of course the comment I get the most often is, well, it doesn't rain here, and at least not in summertime. So I really want to address that, because the truth is, historically, desert communities survived solely on rainwater, and we can't even call ourselves a desert community, even in this drought. Sorry, folks. So let's dive into reasons to harvest rainwater and kind of how to go about thinking about sizing a system for your place. But there are a handful of reasons. These are kind of my top five for why to harvest rainwater. Saving money is an interesting one. You certainly will reduce your water bill in some way, or if you're on a well, reduce your pumping costs. Rainwater harvesting there is an upfront cost to putting in a system. And the truth is, even though we love to complain about our water bills, the price we pay per gallon, if you've ever really analyzed it and broken it down, it's fractions of a penny. So the market doesn't necessarily encourage water conservation, which is sort of an interesting aspect. What I find is that most people are really motivated to harvest rainwater for a couple of reasons. Environmental reasons are huge, and we will definitely go over those. And then the nourish your plants item, rainwater is a superior quality water for plants. You'll notice the health of your garden just increase. And even if you're a interior potted plant type of gardener, you'll really notice the difference, because of the potted plants tend to really accumulate salts and chemicals and things like that are found in other sources. Rainwater is free of all that. Emergency preparedness, I like to just touch on that. I like to bring up at the very beginning that rainwater, when it's stored, is not potable, and that's very important. You're not going to go up to your water tank and drink out of it. But it would be similar. You get a little beneficial biology going on inside of your tank with the stuff that comes off your roof, mostly organic matter. So it would be similar to drinking out of a creek or a stream. So if your goal is to be prepared for emergencies, if you keep, you know, personal use treatment techniques available, boiling, bleach, or, you know, go to REI and check out their water treatment section, you'll be happier than the next person if for any reason your other water source becomes unavailable. Increasing awareness and well-being, that's the big kind of, I've found that since I've become a rainwater harvester, I'm just so much more aware of the flows, not only water flows, but just the health of my garden and seasonality and everything. It's helped me become much more in tune with what the environment's actually telling us on a daily basis. So just to delve into a couple of these items a little bit more, nourish your plants. So there are a few reasons that plants like rainwater better than any other water source. Some of them are obvious and some of them are not so obvious. So the first being rainwater, you know, it's water evaporates from the ground, collects in the clouds, and it rains back down on us. Well, when it evaporates, it leaves behind all the salts and chemicals that it's ever accumulated. So when it rains back down on us, it's virtually pure and clean. It's got nothing in it. It's 100% soft water, no chemicals, no treatment chemicals, nothing like that, no salts. So you'll find that when you irrigate, the plants, I mean, think about walking through your garden after a rainstorm. All the plants are breathing and they're smiling at you and they're just happy, and that's part of the reason why. A second reason that plants love rainwater, when you're storing rainwater in tanks and cisterns, I mentioned this just briefly, it's been collected off your roof, so it's collected a small amount of organic matter, and that creates what we call a beneficial biology inside of the tank. That it's a little bit ironic, and they didn't know this till more recent studies, but ARCSA commissions a lot of studies, mostly through the University of Texas, to study water quality in tanks and things like that. And what they found is that it used to be a blanket recommendation to clean out a rain tank every year. They've taken that recommendation away. Now the recommendation is never clean a rain tank unless you have some particular reason to believe something really bad is happening inside. Because when they test the water, they find that when you let that beneficial biology take place, the water is cleaner. So there's sort of almost a composting action going on. And then you get, when you water with that water, it's like a very light application of fertilizer every single time with what's going on in there. And I should say, we'll talk a little bit about system anatomy a little later, but water does get pre-filtered, and that's a code requirement going into the tank. So we're not talking about gobs of, you know, algae and nasty stuff growing in your tanks. We're talking about just a very thin, what's called a biofilm, that develops on the inside of the tank, and that's been proven to be a beneficial element. And then the third big reason that plants love rainwater is because of the pH. So if any of you do any organic vegetable gardening at home, if you've read about organic vegetable gardening, you probably know that ideal soil pH ranges from 5.5 to 6.5. Now that's on slightly on the acidic side of the pH 7 neutral, and that's the pH of rainwater as it falls. I just learned this, I didn't know this, but most municipal water sources are actually treated to be on the alkaline side, and that's to protect all the metal pipe network so that, you know, copper pipes and things like that don't corrode. So when you water with city water as opposed to, or rainwater as opposed to city water, you'll find that you really help keep your soil pH really naturally in balance. So for all those reasons, if you're collecting rainwater, and we'll talk a little bit about the sizing principles, often in our climate it's difficult to store enough rainwater to irrigate your whole garden all summer. Some people manage to do that. For some people, it's not realistic. If you're doing a rain barrel or a couple of rain barrels and doing it on a small scale, consider using that water for your plant starts or for potted plants, because those are the ones that really suffer the most with the salts and the chemicals and the pH. They're the most sensitive. So you could think of it that way. To delve into the environmental aspects, there are lots of environmental benefits, and again, some are very obvious, some are less obvious. When you harvest rainwater that falls on the roof, you're reducing your draw on stress resources, and by that stress resources, I mean the rivers we all draw from, the underground aquifers, but also the underground pipe networks that I keep hearing about in the news, that they're kind of decaying, like, quicker than we want them to, and they're reaching the ends of their life cycle, and these are very expensive, public projects. So the more each household can reduce their draw on all of these different types of stress systems, the longer we prolong the life of our aquifers and the pipes and all of those things. Restoring the hydrologic cycle, that has to do with kind of how water is delivered globally, and I have a better slide to get into more depth on that. Reducing runoff. So here in California, many people are attracted to rainwater harvesting because of the water conservation aspect, which is very important, of course. Like, the more water you collect, the less you're drawing from our stress resources. On the flip side of that, you're also mitigating the storm water that can overwhelm systems at the same time. So it's easy for us to forget that even in our dry climate and even in a drought, we have stormwater impacts, and they can be very significant, and those cause stream bank erosion and things like that. EPA says that stormwater pollution is the number one source of pollution in the USA by far, actually. So the more water you take out of that deluge stormwater picture, and then of course it's available for you to use at a drier time on your site and let it infiltrate more naturally, you're helping the runoff situation too. And then the last one, I always like to talk about energy use because a lot of people don't consider this. In the state of California, a full 20% of our per capita energy use is dedicated to treating, heating, pumping, transporting water. And when you think about how heavy water is, that does make sense, and how much we use, and we heat it, and we do all kinds of things with it. So the more you can shift your water use to non-pumped, non-treated sources, like the water that's sitting in your big old rain cistern in your backyard, you have a commensurate reduction in your carbon footprint. So I want to talk about the hydrologic cycle a little bit, and you know, I've done some work with schools. I'll do similar talks in schools. So I always ask the teacher, you know, will your students be offended if we start with the hydrologic cycle, because they probably just learned it, right? We all learned this in fourth grade, and the teacher always says, no, it's good for a refresher. And I found that for all of us, you know, this is such basic sort of macro science, but it's good to understand how what we do on our sites plugs into what's going on globally. So just very quickly, hydrologic cycle, water evaporates from the ocean and from the surface of the earth, condenses into clouds, rains back down, and then in a natural environment, a lot of that water infiltrates to recharge groundwater sources. Some of it becomes surface flow, and the whole thing starts over. Well, here's what our human communities have managed to accomplish with all this wonderful development that we've done in the last couple of hundred of years. So on the left, this is a comparative graphic. On the left, what you're looking at is what happens in a natural ground cover, infiltration-wise, and on the right, that's compared to a developed landscape. So natural ground cover, we could be talking about a forest, we could be talking about a savanna, we could even be talking about a desert. The proportions are about the same. That you see 40% of the water that falls on a natural landscape actually evaporates or evapotranspirates through plants and animals. And goes right back up to the sky. But we have 25% each shallow and deep infiltration. So a full 50% of the water that falls in a natural landscape infiltrates and recharges our groundwater. And only 10% becomes runoff. So runoff is a normal part of the hydrologic cycle, but it's in a natural environment, there's not very much water that's running off. And you have that nice soft forest floor to absorb the impact, so you don't have the same pollution and erosion problems that we have in a developed landscape. If you look, I apologize if these are too small, so I'll read the numbers, but in a developed landscape where we have on average 75% impervious ground cover, so that means roads, driveways, the roof over our head, even lawns are counted as impervious ground cover. They tend to sheet water off rather than absorbing it. The numbers are basically flipped. So we have 10 and 5% shallow and deep infiltration. So from 50% all the way down to 15% infiltration. And a whopping 55% runoff. So we've essentially flipped those two numbers upside down. And that is a big part of the reason that we feel that it's so dry here and we have water shortage issues. Let me just check the timer. Yeah.
So if you have people that are building up above you, and normally there wasn't a house there, and now there's four or five other houses there, 55% of that, more than half of it, is running off.
If they're upstream from you, they're creating more runoff that will eventually affect your property too. And you've affected the people downstream from you in the same way with your own property. Yeah, that's how it works. So just really quickly, what this slide is showing us, it's reminding us that we talk about water conservation. In some ways, it's a misnomer. We don't have any less water on the planet than we ever did since the beginning of time. All the water molecules are still with us. They just get redistributed in funny ways. And with that top sort of flat square represents global water supply. And then that more blocky looking section of it is broken down below it. And that's the fresh water versus salt water. So the rest of it is oceans. The huge block you see in the middle is fresh water that's in glaciers. So that's not accessible to us either. And you keep breaking it down. And what we find is about 0.75%. Of the global water supply is available to us as groundwater, which we now have the ability to pump. Human societies didn't always have as advanced abilities to do that. Only 0.007 is available in lakes and rivers, which is the more sort of traditional way for humans to meet water needs. So this is just a more graphic version of that. This is the globe, and again, sorry about the definition here. It's pretty bright in here, but the huge bubble you see represents global water supply. The small bubble you see is fresh water. And then the tiny bubble, which you probably don't see, it's just right above Florida there, is the water that our entire global population, so you know, not just our town, not just our state, not just our nation, the entire global population shares access to that water. So when we pave over our communities and let the water run off, it's that water we're saying goodbye to. Whereas if we weren't paved in the way that we were, much more of that would be infiltrating and we'd have a much more locally sustainable sort of water system. So this is the U.S. Drought Monitor, and this slide's from way back in January. They update this every single week. But I left the January slide in because 2013, so far, is the driest year on record for the state of California. So this is what the drought map looked like following 2013. This is what it looks like today. So, and then here's a zoom in on California. So I know the numbers are too small to read, and in some ways they're not important. But if you know that darker is bad, then that's what we're looking at here. This isn't meant to be a scare tactic presentation because I'm about to show a slide that paints a totally different picture. And the truth is there are people who sit in boardrooms and decide, well, what number are we going to assign to purple and what number are we going to assign to red? There's a woman from the East Bay named Elizabeth Dougherty who runs Holy H2O, and she does a lot of advocacy around the water that comes from the Hetch Hetchy. I heard her speak recently, and she said it was right after Jerry Brown had declared this emergency state of drought. And she said, well, the governor just declared an emergency state of drought. And she said, what I wish he had done was declare an emergency state of normal, because the truth is, there's historical records to suggest that what we're experiencing now is much more normal historically, and we're coming off of a 100, 200-year wet period. And that's the time that we spent building up all of our communities and paving everything over. So the trick is, it's not that we don't have enough water, and I'm about to show you the more hopeful side of this. It's that the way we think about it and the way we draw our water from underground sources or from far away streams and reservoirs, it is leading to this whole effect of water just leaving and making our map look like this. So do you notice when you drive around California now that everything's red? Like, no, not quite. Okay, so this is true, and this is also true, and what we need to do is reconcile how both of these things can be true. So this is a place-based assessment, and every time I speak, I do this for the community that we're sitting in. So what you do, and this is actually the most, when I did this, I like said, no way, and then I checked the math, and you guys have no idea what I'm talking about because I haven't explained it yet, but this is a really interesting one. So what you do for a place-based assessment, the goal is to figure out what's your per capita water budget within your community based on what falls from the sky, because that's how our water replenishes itself. So what you need to know is your average annual rainfall, the land area that you're considering. And we have to forget for a minute that you know, political boundaries are artificial, but that's important to remember at a certain point. And then the population that lives within that boundary that's being served by that water. So Portola Valley, average rainfall somewhere around 30. Now, granted, we haven't been getting average in recent years, but we have to start somewhere. Land area, 9.1 square miles, population about 4,500. So you do a bunch of unit conversion and you figure out GPCD is gallons per capita per day. So the town of Portola Valley, this was the number I was like, what? And I had to do it again, but the math is right. Almost 3,000 gallons per person per day is the water budget in this community based on just what falls from the sky. Now, what do we use? According to a town council report that I dug up online, 2013 use was only 306. Now, I should tell you, I've done this for a lot of communities. 306 is really, really high, really high. Most Northern California communities are around between 130 and 160 a day. So it might have something to do with larger properties, more irrigation, things like that. But what, I mean, the thing I want you to notice is that we're all screaming drought, yet we have, you know, oh, you know, today's not going to be my day for quick math, but how many, almost 10 times as much water falling as we use. But what's happening to that water? It's, you know, that's not how our society gets water. We get it from the Hetch Hetchy, is that right? That's what Lovering told me this morning. So we're transporting it long distances, buying it from the city of San Francisco, spending lots of money and lots of resource and energy. So I'll just tell you, because of the layout of this community and the low population, I just did one of these in Davis, California, which is almost exactly the same land area. The numbers are much closer, but in almost every place, it's revealing to see. It's more typical to say, wow, we get 2 to 6 times as much water falling on our heads. You guys have 10 times and more, or, well, less, but usually the numbers are a little closer, but it's still the same aha moment. We get more water falling on our heads than we could ever figure out what to do with, but we let it all go away. So why? I mean, this slide, I'm just trying to show the starkest juxtaposition I can between a healthy watershed on the left and what human communities are capable of on the right. And that's the difference. So if you can imagine rain falling on the left, that whole forest is just breathing, the water's rolling off that mountain, and snowmelt is rolling off that mountain, and that whole system doesn't need any help surviving. It has all the nutrient and water cycling that it needs. On the right, we have a very extreme sort of example, but we could probably find some landscapes that look like that not too far away from here. If you think about the Earth's surface as skin, I mean, your skin needs to live and breathe, and imagine just coating that with unpermeable stuff. I mean, that's a pretty miserable environment. So here what we're looking at is a channelized stream and then just basically 100% pavement. What I wish I had was one of those neat architect animations where you start with a picture like the one on the right, and then you show the urban greening process, and you have gardens showing up on rooftops and people de-channelizing the streams and doing stream bank restoration and front yard gardens and all this kind of stuff. So we'll have to just imagine that together, that, you know, there are ways on your own property to really help the situation. And there's a lot that can be done, even with the diagram on the right, to just help bring it back into balance and restore that landscape's ability to infiltrate water. So that's sort of the basic background that leads me to some of the, okay, well, what do we do and what does rainwater harvesting have to do with any of this? I want to just introduce rainwater harvesting, as there are a couple different ways to approach it, and passive versus active is something that's worth defining, because it's not necessarily obvious to a lot of people. But passive rainwater harvesting refers simply to what we just talked about. I have 10 minutes left. Okay, so we're gonna, I think that's about right. We'll get there. Passive rainwater harvesting just has to do with reconfiguring your landscape to infiltrate water. So we're not talking about tanks and cisterns in this case, we're talking about a shovel and some time spent, you know, instead of many, especially suburban environments, are very carefully designed to shunt water off and away from the building foundation. If you get out there with a shovel, what you can do is help kind of reconfigure your landscape and use earthworks to create infiltration basins and swales and slow the flow of that water across your site so that it can sink into the ground instead of leaving your site. Active rainwater harvesting, on the other hand, is the act of actually storing the water, collecting it in tanks or cisterns, which takes some more inputs, but then that water is available to you for use as you see fit. So just to get into a little bit what a passive rainwater harvesting system might look like, this, you could imagine this as a cross-section either of a infiltration basin, which is a static feature, or as a cross-section of a bioswale, which would snake across your property. But either way, it's a dugout that's designed to collect the water. The layer on the bottom is a gravel layer, which can really help, especially in more clay soils, but that's a way of helping giving the water a place to collect so it has more time to percolate. And then, you know, we're not just talking about ditches or holes in the ground. They can be made very beautiful with a layer of soil and then actually vegetating these channels so that, and of course it's that challenge of finding all the manuals I've ever seen for how to build a bioswale or a rain garden say, find the drought-tolerant, water-loving plant, those plants that love being totally dry and love being totally wet, but they must exist because they're specified in every one of these plants. But the idea being that you could keep this vegetated year-round. An active system, and this is what my company does, the Blue Barrel system is an active system, although this is not a picture of Blue Barrel system, this is a picture of a tank. These are the basic components of a system. They're actually really simple. So the first thing is a filter, and this is a California code requirement. All the water has to pass through 16th inch mesh on its way into tanks. And that's not only to keep particulates out, it's also a mosquito and vector control thing. You don't want to leave any, so actually you were asking about open tanks earlier. Any aperture on a tank, if you have an open barrel, it needs to be covered with mesh. The vents in your barrels have to be covered with the mesh. Any opening would leave a way for insects to get in and breed, and we don't want that. So the mesh does two things. First flush is an optional feature. That's a way of automatically diverting the first flow of water off your roof, because in a climate like ours where it's dry all summer, you can imagine the first rain carries the heaviest sediment load. I don't think we have time today to get into the more technical aspects of how to build them, but what you see in this diagram, that pipe that goes down into the bucket before the cistern, that's the first flush. So the idea being the first rain goes down and then the sediments kind of settle at the bottom and then the water keeps filling that pipe so that it's cleaner water spilling over into the tank. That's the idea. Now, I'll just mention those are optional. A lot of professionals will say now they're more trouble than they're worth and it's the only part of the system that requires maintenance and people don't do it and then it creates problems. So many systems are built and perfectly soundly into code without first flush systems. You need an inlet. That's very simply the way of getting the water into the tank. You have your whole conduit system. People say, you know, my house doesn't have gutters. You need some way of you need gutters and a downspout because that's where you're going to intercept the water. Storage is the tank or cistern itself. The outlet is how you get the water out. So in this diagram, this is very typical. You see there's like a little spigot about a foot off the ground. And that's typical because usually tanks sit on the ground. With our system, the Blue Barrel system, we actually elevate them a little bit and plumb them from underneath so that the spigot is underneath and that gives you access to all the water you're storing rather than leaving a whole big percent of your water inaccessible. The overflow, you know what, your tank will fill, and I hope we have time to talk about sizing. Even in a dry climate, you'll be amazed how fast even a large tank might fill. So for much of the year, it's just overflowing. You need to give the water a way to come out. And in this diagram, they have the overflow going into the roots of that tree, which is a nice way to combine active and passive rainwater harvesting. And then vents, very important. Every tank or barrel in a system, even if you have multiple tanks chained together, each one has to be vented because the water can't get in if the air can't get out. And then foundation, in parentheses, because it's not a core piece of the anatomy, but it's really important. Water's heavy. A 55-gallon rain barrel weighs 500 pounds when it's full. So it's got to be sitting on something level and stable. So this is actually, this is the prototype for the Blue Barrel system. I know it's hard to see here. This is a 22-barrel system that we did all of our experimenting on and learned a bunch of lessons the hard way. But It has the same pieces of anatomy in a totally different combination, because the storage is 22 little barrels instead of one big one. Here, what our blue barrel system does, you know, it can be built small. The two barrel system is our smallest, actually. We don't do a single rain barrel because the whole design is defined by the way they're tied together on the bottom. So if you notice, that tap is actually down below, and it gives access to all the water in the whole system. So you don't actually need a tap on every barrel. Instead of one tank overflowing into the next, they actually, the water goes in at one point and they all bottom fill. All the water levels throughout the whole system. So it's a way on a small footprint to get a bunch of smaller vessels to function as one larger tank. So, you know, two is our smallest, 42 is the biggest to date. That system's in Santa Rosa, and it serves a 250 square foot vegetable garden all through the summer. And we do them in schools, and we sell these as do-it-yourself kits now for people all over the map. So I want to talk about sizing. We probably have about 5 minutes left. Okay, so there are three things to consider when you size a system. First is, you can size it based on your catchment surface, and that's an exercise of figuring out, well, how much can I even catch? You're going to find that that number will blow your mind. It's like, whoa, I mean, I can catch so much. So then you start to consider, well, how much am I going to use? And then in our climate, often your decision is made based on spatial constraints or budgetary constraints. Those two things kind of go hand in hand. But you're definitely, I promise you, not going to catch all the water you can. I've read the news, like these crazy stories where people have done that, but it's like tons of storage. Even storing enough based on to meet your whole irrigation need for many people in our climate isn't realistic. Some people do manage to do it. This is a recent system. Actually, we did a hands-on workshop last Saturday in Santa Rosa, and this is the very system we installed. And I left this slide in here because Santa Rosa also has 30 inches of rain a year. It's the same average rainfall as here. So we installed 22 barrels, which is about 1,200 gallons, collecting off of just 650 square feet of rooftop. So that's what we're looking at there. And here's the math. And I'm going to talk through this really fast because I'm going to tell you a much easier way to do it it's just unit conversion. So 30 inches a year is 2.5 feet a year times a 650 square foot catchment surface is 1,600 cubic feet of water. Now, this blew my mind. I used to think of a cubic foot. I mean, imagine a ruler, right, in a cube. And then imagine a gallon of milk. I used to think, what, 2.5 gallons in a cubic foot? It's 7.5. It's amazing. So that cubic foot figure translates to over 12,000 gallons annually. Now, there are 22 barrels or 1,200 gallons. So they can catch off that mere section of their house 10 times as much as they're storing. So that just shows you. Now, here's what you need to remember if you're going to do this quick calculation at home. 0.6 gallons per square foot of rooftop surface per inch of rain that falls. So on a 1,000 square foot house, which would be a very modest size home, for every inch that falls on that roof, you get 600 gallons. That's 11 rain barrels. So you're getting a lot of water if you start thinking about it that way. Now, even an easier way to do it, on our website, bluebarrelsystems.com, under, we have a do-it-yourself tab, and one of the sub-tabs is size your system. We have a calculator there. So you can go just enter your roof square footage. Now, what this diagram is trying to show, when you measure your roof square footage, the pitch actually doesn't matter. You're just looking at the flat footprint area. So if you're in a single-story home, you can use your interior square footage as a proxy. Usually, you have a little more. You have overhangs and covered patios and things like that. And a garage that's usually not in your interior square footage that will figure in. And then, of course, I have a lot of people ask me, okay, well, I figured out where I'm going to put my system. Now I just have to figure out how to reroute all the downspouts in my house. Well, I send people to this calculator before they spend too much time and effort figuring out how to tee in all of their downspouts, because what you find, what's more practical than measuring your whole house is going to the downspout that you think you're going to tie into, figuring out how much rooftop surface drains into that. You can go to Google Earth, find an aerial of your house, and use their measurement tools. So you don't even have to bust out your tape measure. But you enter your footprint area and then enter the rainfall. And so this, I was actually analyzing the same Santa Rosa system here. I put 650 square feet for that section of roof. And I wanted to see how much rainfall I had to enter to fill the 1,200 gallon system that we installed there. And the answer was 3.1. So not very much rain. They'll be full, you know, before New Year easily, even if it continues. You know, and I'm not sure, the sub-ecosystems are really different, so I don't know what you guys have experienced in this last couple of years. We've been really, really, really dry. But we certainly get 3.1 inches and much, much more than that. So this kind of, the picture I'm trying to paint is rainwater harvesting is a really good way, even when it's really dry, to help restore this functioning hydrologic cycle that we still live in, but that we've managed to do a lot of damage to, but it's not irreversible. We can all do things on our property to help. So that's kind of all I got. I don't know if we have time for questions. I always like to take questions.